Good evening, everyone. We welcome you all to Ortho TV original webinar series. Today we have a consultant pediatric orthopedic surgeon, Dr. Mandar Agashe. He is attached to SRCC Children's Hospital, Mumbai, and he is going to talk to us on skeletal dysplasias, an idiot's guide for diagnosis and management. This webinar has been brought to us by Dr. Reddy's lab, the makers of Omi's Nice Gel and Ultra Nice. So over to Dr. Mandar Agashe.
Thank you, Dr. Bijlani. So, skeletal dysplasias. Now, skeletal dysplasia is something which we are always scared of. And for us common orthopedic surgeons, we are really a form of idiot in terms of skeletal dysplasia, about what to do about it. Because whenever we hear the word skeletal dysplasia, this is what we think of. Oh God, save me. And we have so many terms when we think of skeletal dysplasias. Achondroplasia, pseudoachondroplasia, spondyloepiphyseal dysplasias. So what do all these mean? So when I was searching for this lecture, I saw this very nice meme where they give various aspects of various doctors. So if you look at the extreme left, you can see a typical orthopedic surgeon like us, just thinking of, can't we just saw the leg off, just looking at surgeries. At the other end of the spectrum, we have a very cute geneticist, a nerdy looking geneticist, who gives something which is very grave. You are one in a million, you have an incurable disease, looking at only the genetic aspect of it. What I would like to do in this lecture is to be something like a clinician, to give you some pointers about the diagnosis and further management of a few types of common skeletal dysplasias. So what is skeletal dysplasia? So skeletal, as we know, is bone. Dysplasia means disordered formation. So basically, disorders of bone formation. And in order to know what is skeletal dysplasia, we should know what is not skeletal dysplasia. So skeletal dysplasia is not disordered bone formation due to metabolic cause. So it's not rickets, it's not scurvy. Or it is not other causes of disordered bone formation, which can be infection, trauma, malnutrition, renal causes, hepatic causes, others. So we have a very long definition of skeletal dysplasia, a heterogeneous group of more than 200 disorders, which has characteristic disproportionate dwarfism or disproportionate short stature. Now the operative word here is disproportionate. So what does this mean? So if you look at dwarfism or short stature, you have two types. One is proportionate and second is disproportionate. Now, what do you mean by proportionate? So if you recall, there was a movie which was made by Shah Rukh Khan. I don't know whether anyone saw it, but you may have seen the poster, which was Zero. You see that in this movie, Shah Rukh Khan was a proportionate dwarf. That is, the proportions of his body segments were as like another normal growing human being. As against that, there was a very famous movie when we were growing up, Appu Raja. It was a legendary movie in which Kamal Hassan had played a double role, in which one of the twins was this. And in fact, what he had done for acting during this film is that he had tied his own thigh with the leg so that he was walking on his knees. So this showed that there was a disproportion between his upper segment and the lower segment. So this is what is known as disproportionate dwarf, and that is what is skeletal dysplasia. So in disproportionate dwarfism, there are two types. So if you look at a dwarf who is a short statured person who is looking disproportionate, he can be either short limb dwarfism or short trunk dwarfism. What does that mean? Now, short limb means you have the upper segment or the head and the upper segment, which is much bigger than the lower segment. And if you recall, there was this very famous character from the series Game of Thrones, the Tyrion Lannister. So you can see that his upper segment, the head and the trunk, is much longer than the lower segment. So this is a short limb dwarfism. As against that, if you recall, there was a professor in Harry Potter series, who was like this. He was known as Professor Flitwick. And here you can see that his trunk was much smaller than his lower limbs. So this is known as a short trunk dwarfism. The common causes of short limb dwarfism is the commonest, which is achondroplasia. Well, short trunk dwarfism is SED or spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia and mucopolysaccharidosis. We'll go to that later on. So if you see a suspected case of skeletal dysplasia, what do you do? Look at the whole body and the proportion. So first know whether it is short limb dwarfism or short trunk dwarfism, and look at the limb segments. So in every limb, there are three limb segments. One is the proximal segment, which is the humerus and the femur. Second is the middle segment, which is the radius ulna and the tibia fibula. And third is the lower segment, which is the hand and the feet. So anything which involves shortening of the entire lower limb is micromalia. Anything which involves shortening of the extremities of the proximal segment is rhizomelia. Mesomelia is intermediate segment, and acromelia is the distal segment. So there are various types of dwarfism or skeletal dysplasia, which are rhizomelic, commonly which is achondroplasia or spondyloepiphyseal dysplasias. Mesomelic, again, there are various forms of mesomelic dysplasias, and acromelic are something known as acrodysostosis. So look at the body segments or the limb segments, and we can give a pointer towards what sort of diagnosis is there for the skeletal dysplasias. Then look at special features. Look at abnormal facies, frontal bossing, cauliflower ears, various forms of hand deformities, joint stiffness, organomegaly, systemic features, at which time a common orthopedic surgeon is bored. He's going to say, show me the x-rays. So the proforma or the protocol to in any case, suspected case of skeletal dysplasia is this. So you look at the various parts of the x-ray. Look at whether it is a primary epiphyseal involvement. Secondly, whether it's a primary metafyseal involvement. Thirdly, if you feel that the entire bone architecture is altered, so altered bone density disorders. And fourth, there are miscellaneous or unclassifiable disorders. So let's look at each of them. So primary epiphyseal involvement, these are quite common. So let's start from the less severe to the more severe. So you have x-rays like this, where only the epiphyses are involved, like the proximal femur, and the spine is not involved. This is something known as multiple epiphyseal dysplasias. These are significantly less involved in individuals. The height is marginally less than normal. They have some joint deformities, coxavara, knee flexion deformities, but they have otherwise a good prognosis. They may require a few corrective orthopedic surgeries, if any. Then you come to, again, other forms of primary epiphyseal involvement like this. You can see that the epiphyseal segment is much more involved. You can see that there is a lot of chondral punctate picture, and spine is very less involved. This is a chondral involvement and typically known as chondrodysplasia punctata. A punctate involvement of the cartilage is chondrodysplasia punctata. There are other systemic features, like wide forehead, hypertelorism, depressed nasal bridge for chondrodysplasia punctata. Then we have something like this. Here, the epiphyses you can see are small. The spine is fairly normal. The spine is not involved. And you have these characteristic features, which are polysyndactyly, a tibial varus deformity, and this is typically known as Ellis Van Creveld syndrome. And one of the very characteristic features of Ellis Van Creveld syndrome is something known as natal teeth. What does natal teeth mean? Is that the teeth which are present at birth, as you know, teeth are present, start becoming present only after 6 months. But if there is natal teeth with these features, it is typically known as Ellis Van Creveld syndrome. Again, a spine, primary epiphyseal involvement with this, but with spine which is significantly involved. So now we go to slightly further involved individuals. So you have epiphyseal involvement, but with spine involved. This is known as spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia. Spondylo is spine, epiphyseal is epiphyseal, and dysplasia. So epiphysis involvement with spine is spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia. Quite common, relatively quite common, short tongue dysplasia, like the Professor Flitwick in Harry Potter. Profound spinal issues. Now this is very important. Typically the kids come with limb deformities, but always screen the cervical spine especially. They have atlantoaxial dislocations, they have craniovertebral anomalies, they have scoliosis. The cervical spine issues are extremely important for the anesthetic point of view. Unless we screen and clear the cervical spine, we should not embark on any corrective surgery from the orthopedic point of view. Then we have this here, the epiphysis and metaphysis also are involved. The spine is involved, but the face is normal. Now here you can see that there is significant involvement of the epiphysis and the metaphysis, significant deformities, significant hand deformities, but you have a dwarf with a normal face. So this normal faced dwarf is something known as pseudoachondroplasia. The kids are normal at birth. Spine does have some platyspondyle with central baking. So it has involvement of the epiphysis, metaphysis with spine. So that is typical of pseudoachondroplasia. Lastly, we have this where the metaphysis also is involved. Spine has platybasia anterior baking, but what is characteristic in these features is that there are significant systemic symptoms. Remember, in most of these skeletal dysplasias, there are no systemic features. The systemic symptoms here is characteristic of a group of disorders known as mucopolysaccharidosis. These are significant systemic involvement. They are heterogeneous group of lysosomal storage disorders with accumulation of glycosaminoglycans. There is profound organ dysfunction, organomegaly, mental retardation, and developmental delay in various permutations and combinations depending on what type of mucopolysaccharidosis it is. Thus, remember, if you see a suspected case of mucopolysaccharidosis, a genetic evaluation is extremely important because we should know what is the life expectancy of that patient. Then we come to primary metafacial involvement. This is quite simple. Primary predominantly metafacial involvement like this, the spine involved, but no platyspondyle. That is very important. Large skull wall with base of skull animals. So if you see a skull like this, achondroplasia. Now achondroplasia is the commonest non-lethal skeletal dysplasia. You can see achondroplasia is very common. They have normal life expectancy, normal intelligence, but they have some limb deformities with spinal issues like lumbar canal stenosis. Always screen the spine if you are going to do anything orthopedically for these kids. Then we have altered bone disorders. Now bone density can be either high, that is osteosclerotic, it can be either low, that is osteopenic, or irregular. So you have altered bone density where there is osteopenia, typically associates with fractures and deformities, and the commonest is osteogenesis imperfecta. It is a connective tissue disorder due to COLL1 mutation. It has brittle bones, blue sclera, dentigenesis imperfecta. Again, there are various types of osteogenesis imperfecta which are keeping on adding themselves. But basically, they have these few features. The treatment is medical in the form of bisphosphonates and surgical in the form of treatment of fractures or treatment of deformities. Then we have osteosclerotic skeletal dysplasias. Typically like this, you have deformities with fractures. Osteopetrosis is the commonest. It is known, also known as marble bone disease. It's a prototype of these osteosclerotic disorders. There are many others. The typical feature is loss of medullary canal with limb deformities and fractures. There is a type of osteopetrosis which is infantile osteopetrosis. It has grave prognosis. What happens is that there is very little marrow to form WBCs and the other blood cells, and it has grave prognosis. It has profound pancytopenia and organomegaly, and usually kids do not survive beyond the first decade. Then there is altered bone density. You can see that there are some patches of osteosclerosis, some patches of osteopenia, has bone pains, progressive deformities, irregular bone density, and severe deformities of the proximal femur, which is typically known as the Shepherd Crook deformity. And this is known as fibrous dysplasia. It can be monoosteotic or polyosteotic. It has a ground glass appearance with endosteal scalloping and pathological fractures. This needs to be treated with medically with either bisphosphonates and with surgically by correction of the deformity. Lastly, we have a few miscellaneous or unclassifiable disorders. If you have, because you see these disorders of the nail, some iliac wings, and small patella. So what is this? Nail patella syndrome. Then you have something like this. Something which is characteristically seen here is that there are no clavicles and some deformities in the skull bones. So this is known as cleidocranial dysplasia. So the, all right. So the question to be asked is, what is a pediatric orthopedic surgeon going to do this? Why am I giving this lecture? So basically, my association with skeletal dysplasia started with this man, Professor Hai Rong Song from the Rare Diseases Institute, Seoul, where I did my fellowship with. He was a tremendous expert in skeletal dysplasia. And these are two of my inspirations. One is this lady who was the president of the Little People Korea Society at that time. As you can see, the two of us are sitting and she is standing. So this shows how much of disproportionate dwarfism is in. And she was completely inspirational. She was doing everything and she was helping a lot of people. Along with that, this person was in the Osteogenesis Imperfecta Foundation and was helping a lot of people with skeletal dysplasias. So we should ask, what does an orthopedic surgeon want when we see a child with skeletal dysplasia? If we are sending it to a geneticist, we want whether it is lethal, non-lethal, and what is the life expectancy of this child. We should know what are the orthopedic issues. They have come for limb deformities for which we need to correct it. Have they come for the spinal issues? Have they come for shortening? And before this, we should remember to always screen the spine. As I told you again and again, we should always screen the spine, because any issue in the spine, and if we the anesthetist intubates, there can be a lethal event in case of something like an atlantoaxial dislocation or craniovertebral anomalies. What about limb lengthening in skeletal dysplasias? So what is the concept of limb lengthening in skeletal dysplasias? So if you see this person, this is a normal growing person, you can see that there is a normal upper segment and lower segment ratio. In the achondroplast, typically where the limb lengthening is performed in some countries or some populations, you can see that there is disproportion. There is a significantly long or almost a normal size upper segment and a significantly short lower segment. So basically, limb lengthening is performed in order to decrease the disproportion between the upper segment and the lower segment. So what we do is we lengthen the distal segment or the lower segment. So the child is always going to be slightly shorter than the normal population, but we convert a disproportionate dwarf into a proportionate short statured person. But is limb lengthening effective, safe, and helpful in improving quality of life? There is one paper of mine where we had discussed this. It does improve quality of life. However, whether limb lengthening is to be performed or not, is that individual's choice, is that family's choice, and that cultural tradition's choice, which means that most people in the US do not encourage limb lengthening in dwarfism or in achondroplasia, while most of the Southeast Asian countries, there is great acceptance of lengthening in achondroplasia. The verdict is still to be given in the Indian population. Is it all hunky-dory? Are there any complications of lengthenings? Where I had described this in our paper in about growth disturbance after lengthening, where there is some issues with growth disturbance after very early lengthening in achondroplasia. That is why it was given in this paper that the lengthening should be deferred till about 11 years of age. However, this is still controversial. There are some people who have very good success with early lengthenings in achondroplasia. Just finally, take home points about this exhaustive lecture about skeletal dysplasia. Should remember that it is disproportionate dwarfism. It is not idiopathic short stature, where it is a proportionate short stature. We should distinguish between short limb and short trunk dwarfism. Remember Tyrion Lannister versus Professor Flitwick from Harry Potter. Remember about the limb segments, the rhizomelic, the mesomelic, and the acromelic segments. And once you see the X-ray, classify it into epiphyseal, metaphyseal, altered bone density, and miscellaneous. And look at the orthopedic surgeon's point of view from the spine's deformity correction and lengthening point of view. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mandar. Let's keep this slide on for everybody to just summarize and basically take in so much information which you have provided in the last 20-25 minutes. It was a very crisp lecture and you have made it very simple for us to diagnose. So, however, I have a few queries and this slide will help me ask all my queries. Yeah. So, the thing is that achondroplasia lengthening is somehow still not acceptable in India. That is what is the message which you say. But in many countries, they are doing it. So if it has to be done also, it has to be done only after 11 years of age. If any patient comes to you or any parent comes to you that we want lengthening and we want them to become tall because of achondroplasia, we should do it only after the age of 11.
All right. So a small perspective about this paper, what we had done in that was we had compared achondroplasts who have been lengthened. And we had compared those who had not been lengthened for some other financial or social reasons. And what we had found was that the physeal growth of the kids who had been lengthened was slightly hampered as compared to the others. So eventual length had been gained because of the lengthenings. But actual physeal growth, which is anyway less in achondroplasts, was much less. Now, all these lengthening issues are governed by a very powerful body known as Little People Society. There's a Little People Society of every country. So Little People of America, they are very proud people. They are very much against lengthening and they feel that they are fine with however God has given us and they are completely functional in that way. While on the other hand, Little People of Korea Society where I interacted, they were absolutely for this sort of procedure and they found that the results were quite good. So there is also a cultural aspect also. Coming to India, we still do not have guidelines about whether an achondroplast should be lengthened or not. There are some people who are doing a great amount of work with lengthening of achondroplast, even early lengthenings of achondroplast. However, what should be told to them, to the patients and the parents is that it's not going to be a single shot thing. We should remember that it's going to be a multiple lengthenings. It is going to be multiple segment lengthening. So first femur, then tibia. Then in fact, humerus also needs to be lengthened because what happens is that they have short upper limbs. So once their lower limbs are lengthened, they are unable to do ground level activities like say tying their shoelaces or picking up things from the ground. So they have to lengthen their humeri. So it's not going to be a single shot procedure. They will require multiple procedures over time, probably till puberty or even after that. And even after that, if they ask you whether the child is going to be of normal height, they may not be of normal height. They will be close to normal. Their disproportion is going to decrease, but they will still have some degree less height than an equivalent normal growing population.
Okay. So now when you told about the different types of disproportionate dwarfism where the short limb versus short trunk. So if their limb and if the basically to differentiate is that what I understood is that if the limb and the trunk are the same, that is basically idiopathic and that is not a skeletal dysplasia.
Okay. So when we are born, the child is born with a very increased upper segment or high upper segment with a slightly lower segment ratio. Mm. So upper segment is basically the length between the top of our crown to the pubic symphysis. Mm. And from pubic symphysis to the ground is the lower segment. Now, when a person is full grown or probably after about 8 years or so, what happens is that the lower limbs are increased in size. So the lower segment is slightly higher or longer than the upper segment. So that is what the normal proportion is. A lower segment which is longer than the upper segment. What happens with the disproportion is that one of the segments is much longer than the others. So in case of the commonest, which is the achondroplast, what happens is that if you see an achondroplast who is sitting down, the the trunk is almost of the same height as the any other person. So if you see that photo where the two of us were sitting and the lady was standing, you could see that the trunk is almost the same as compared to others. But the lower limb is much shorter. As against that, if you see that the lower limbs are much longer, but the trunk is quite shorter. If you go back to the Harry Potter episodes, the trunk is much shorter. So that is because the spine is greatly involved. So that also gives a pointer towards the diagnosis that here the spine is greatly involved.
Mm.
So that is why the diagnosis is SED, that is spondyloepiphyseal dysplasia. Right.
But yeah. Okay. So, but as of these actors who are doing quite well in their career as dwarfs, so basically that means they usually don't have much problems.
Yeah. So, in fact, the natural history of it also gives a pointer. Tyrion Lannister, played by Peter Dinklage, has achondroplasia. They have normal life expectancy.
Okay.
Well, the actor who played Professor Flitwick passed away a few years back.
Okay.
Right. So they do have profound issues. They have cervical spine issues. They have spine issues.
Mm-hmm.
So they do have profound issues and their life expectancy is slightly lesser. Kids with mucopolysaccharidosis have a slightly even shorter life expectancy. Mm-hmm. Again, depending on the types of MPS which the child fits in.
And when you showed some metafacial dysplasias where there were multiple deformities, do these patients require correction at each and every deformity or only the symptomatic ones?
Yeah, so typically they have the deformities which need to be corrected are commonest around the knee and the tibia. In fact, Dr. Sandeep Vaidya has a very good paper on bifocal correction of deformity of the tibia.
Hmm.
There are issues with coxa vara, which happens especially in multiple epiphyseal dysplasias.
Mm.
So that needs to be corrected in some kids, especially when they have a significant abductor lurch, which needs to be corrected. Typically, upper limb deformities may not be corrected in these kids, especially because that will require a lot of GA. And again, GA is slightly more tougher or more challenging in these kids. So typically, it's the lower limb deformities which need to be corrected. Around the knee, around the hip. So these are the commonest things.
And coming to the other ones, the density ones, that basically, I actually did not know that they are also called skeletal dysplasias only. The osteogenesis imperfecta, the fibrous dysplasia. I think the fibrous dysplasia is something which an orthopedic surgeon, common orthopedic surgeon will see.
Yes.
Mainly monostotic, more than polystotic, because they will come with pathological fractures or they will come with just one-off. So my first, one of my early career cases was a fibrous dysplasia of the proximal femur. And she fractured around that and we had to do a DHS for her. She fractured, she was having a proximal femur and then we had to do a DHS and she's doing quite well, basically, which I did not expect her to do, but she's doing quite well. So they actually live a normal life.
Correct. So again, monostotic fibrous dysplasias have significantly normal life. There are some systemic associations with polyostotic fibrous dysplasias. Again, that depends on what sort of association it is. Monostotic fibrous dysplasias typically have almost a normal life, except for the deformities, which probably sometimes they need some correction. They may have some bone pains. And also, so again, there is a school of thought where bisphosphonates have been given for fibrous dysplasias and have a good prognosis. Again, that is, the jury is still out about the routine use of bisphosphonates for fibrous dysplasias.
So there is no consensus yet. Now I want to ask you about monostotic fibrous dysplasia, because that is something which everybody may see in the next 1 year or 2 years of their career.
Right.
So do you still give, even if they may just come with a symptom, it may not be a pathological fracture. Do you still give bisphosphonates as a prevention of a fracture in those cases, especially with one lesion or two lesions in the whole body?
Yeah. So again, they are not going to come for asymptomatic bone lesions. They may not come for just X-ray finding, which they have incidentally done. They are going to come for bone pains.
Hmm.
They may come for a deformity.
Hmm.
So the symptomatic fibrous dysplasia, once they are diagnosed, again, an X-ray lesion, MRI finding needs to be biopsied and proved that it is fibrous dysplasia and nothing else. Amongst the other diagnosis of probably a cystic lesion, it can be other malignancies, it can be other issues. Fibrous dysplasia is probably the easier to treat. So you have to do a biopsy of a bone lesion which is suspected to be a monoostotic fibrous dysplasia lesion. Once that is confirmed, then you can probably treat them with bisphosphonates, unless there is a deformity where there is an impending fracture where we try to convince them for a deformity correction.
So now about the fibrous dysplasia biopsy also. So there is an issue that for really diagnosing, you actually need the wall.
Yeah.
You need the wall of it. So do you need to do an open biopsy versus a needle biopsy, which we normally do for other lesions?
No. In fibrous dysplasia, always a J-needle biopsy.
Hmm.
Typically, they are not cysts like a UBC or an ABC, where it's just a wall and there's nothing else. In fact, in UBC or ABC also, the treatment, the biopsy is a J-needle biopsy where you have to scrape the wall and get the scrapings of it. But in case of a fibrous dysplasia, you get a good enough core because it's not always completely cystic. There is a lot of material in it which you can send for biopsy and get a good proper diagnosis for it.
Okay, I think that's it, because the other things like lengthening, deformity and correction and everything, that I think we will keep it for a next lecture and for more focused audience of pediatric orthopedic surgeons. So I thank you for making us realize that about the multiple levels of skeletal dysplasia and how easy it is to diagnose. And when you are in doubt, when there is too many deformities or too many things, it is always better to send to a geneticist.
Absolutely.
So to know, the main reason for sending is to know the life expectancy and the prognosis of the disease, whether you want to overtreat it or you want to undertreat it.
Correct. Absolutely.
Right. Okay. And of course, the common things which we will see in our practice are more dwarfism. So we have to know what kinds of dwarfism we are dealing with. Then fibrous dysplasia, osteogenesis imperfecta with multiple fractures. And we should always differentiate between an osteomalacia versus an osteogenesis imperfecta. Always need to know the difference between them. So thank you very much. Thank you, Mandar.
All right.
Thank you very much for your time. And we have all hopefully getting back to what a sense of normalcy is in our life. And let's hope this coronavirus goes away and we start meeting more frequently. So bye-bye, everyone, and good night.
Thank you, sir.